I haven't held a presentation for some while, so I'm a bit nervous, but I hope it will go good. So I'm gonna be talking a bit about a more direct and participatory support for creators. So I'll be talking a bit about copyright, a bit about what's wrong with copyright today. Probably hear a lot more from Julia tomorrow. I'll be talking a bit about how to hack copyright and use alternative funding, mainly in through micro donations. So a way of funding creators in a new technological world. My name is Josef Ohlsson Collentine. I'm a Swedish pirate, international contact person, and one of the founders of Pirate Times, which is an international news service. And been involved in international pirate activities for quite some time now. So copyright, what is wrong with copyright and why do we have copyright at all? I'll start just shortly by presenting tiny history about copyright. As usual, when it comes to copyright and legislative texts and stuff, there's a big wall of text, so that's what I'm going to present. These are a few of the key laws regarding US copyrights, and US copyrights has been very influential on world copyright, and that's where it comes from. Copyright first started in England, with the Statute of Anne. It was a way of protecting the right to copy, which included giving the library copies of your work and making work more accessible. With the advance of copyright, this hasn't really been the case. It's been more accessible, it's been more restrictive. So it started off in the US in 1790 with a 14-year restriction, a 14-year term, with a possibility of renewing another 14 years. Then they extended it in 1831, extended it again, and as you can see, it goes on and on. That's kind of extending the copyright terms and making it more and more restrictive and longer, and not that good, I would say. But so why is copyright dysfunctional? The first reason is that consumers have not really been satisfied by the market, the way it works. They're not. In a free market, you always have a balance between supply and demand. The way copyright works, for the ones that have studied economics, is a way of enacting an externality on the market. So it's a way of artificially stopping up the free flow of the market. And this causes a disbalance in the market, which is not working good. The recent European Commission report mentions a lot about the gathered information, both from users and from copyright holders and from a bit of everyone. And one of the things you can see there is that the copyright holders are fairly okay with the situation. They don't really want any more copyright, which is a concern because it means there's no balance at all. While the users are complaining and saying they want this and they want that and that should be done better. For example, being able to watch YouTube in your own country, which I'm sure most of you have experiences with as well. It's not so easy. There's a lot of restrictions. Also streaming, there's coming some models for streaming now, but it's mostly because there's been pirate alternatives for so long, so the market has to do something. And also it's often harder getting a legal copy than just going to Pirate Bay and downloading something or finding some streaming site. Or another reason, copyright is not working as it should, it's dysfunctional, as I would say, is that it's not only for content, it's not only for consumption anymore. With the advance of technology, we have become more creators. Everyone can be a creator. You can set up your own podcast studio at home and do podcasts if you want to launch it. And a lot of this means you want to remix other people's content. And remixing is very hard to do with copyright. You have to ask for permission, you have to wait, you have to find the right person. There's a lot of problems with orphan works that you don't really know who is the creator, which becomes a very big problem if you want to remix something. And the third thing I'm going to talk about is the need for control and maintain power. The current way copyright works is they need to maintain this control over people to make sure the system works. And that means more surveillance. For example, if you want to keep track of who's downloading what and they need to pay, then you have to surveillance everyone. So it's a way of pushing for control over the people to ensure that this economic system works. So if copyright is dysfunctional and doesn't work, we have to change it somehow. So as I see it, we have three options with copyright. We can either stagnate it, which means leaving it the status quo, which is what a lot of the copyright holders want because they're very content. I wouldn't say everyone, but at least the collecting firms and other ones are very happy with the way copyright is working today. Second option is a very big option, reforming copyright. You, Larry, they will talk a lot about that tomorrow, so I'm not going to mention it now. And the third option is hacking copyright, making it more accessible. So how do we hack copyright? How do we make it more easy for people to use material and content? One alternative is using Creative Commons. Pretty sure most of you have heard about Creative Commons or know a bit how it works. Using Creative Commons is a way of making copyright more accessible. So you can define that it's fine if you use my work as long as you mention it. Or you can use my work but don't use it for commercial purposes. Or as long as you also share it with an open license like I did, you can use my work. So it's a way of enabling people to reuse content, to remix, to become more creators. So that's a way of hacking copyright and making it more accessible. But then we come to the term of monetization. How do we make money if we're going to give this work away for free? And this is a concern that a lot of people have. So there is a longer quote about art. Basically what this says is we'd like to support art, but we can't be this big patron of art because most of us don't have the resources, we have too much content we like to support everything as much as we'd like. So we're back to the monetization. Can't be these patrons, how can we do it then? Traditional methods: licensing merchandise, live performances, works for some people in some fields. For example, musicians haven't really seen falling declining profits despite piracy. There's been studies showing that their income is still maintained, and a lot of that is due to other sources of revenue. Hacking copyright doesn't mean throwing away traditional methods of funding. For example, you can still do all of these while you have a Creative Commons work. You can still license your work for commercial purposes, you can still do a t-shirt to sell to your fans. So one alternative of monetizing Creative Commons is through crowdfunding. Or it doesn't have to be Creative Commons, it can be any kind of work that you want to put out for free and make more accessible to people. So in crowdfunding, you can either crowdfund something before it is created. The biggest example would be Kickstarter. It has been funding a lot of projects and very successful. And that is basically presenting your idea and saying we want to do this if we have enough money. And it's the same thing as doing grants or doing a speech here at ThinkTwice. I want to do this. Can I come and do that? Can you provide enough support for me to enable that? The other alternative we have is after it has been created. So after you have actually made a content, a webcomic, a blog, or a band, music, you can fund the team. One way of funding after is through micro donations. Micro donations is, just as it sounds, it's a donation but in a very tiny amount. And as long as you have enough small donations, you will gain enough money to be able to continue with your work or do what you're doing. So funding after the content is created is a way of maybe paying off what you did, but in most cases it's a way of funding future similar works. So if you like the first thing you did or she did, you can fund him and enable them to make more of that art. So one example of a firm doing is Flutter. Flutter is a way of saying I want to spend this amount of money on culture each month and giving that to artists or creators that you see their work and you see and appreciate what they have done. So with Flutter, it's kind of like a Facebook super like, that you click a button, I like this content, and by doing so you give a little money to that person that created the content. And it can be all sorts of stuff as well. It can be a podcast, music, live performance, whatever you want. It's kind of like a virtual tip jar, using technology to add money. And another version of micro donation is something called Change Tip, which is a love button for the internet, as they describe themselves. It works through bitcoins. So first of all, you have to have access to bitcoins, and then you can start giving them away. And what ChangeTip does is that it makes it very easy to give other people money. So by mentioning their name, for example, on the services they have integrated, for example, Twitter or SoundCloud or Reddit, you can mention their name and then you can mention an amount and then you mention ChangeTip. And through that you will be giving them a certain amount. And the last example I'm gonna talk a little about is Patreon. And as it says, yeah, patron of the arts. So it's based a bit on the old concept. For example, some of our big artists in the past, Mozart and a few other classical musicians, had their own patrons that were paying for them to become or keep being the musicians and being able to survive. So being a patron of the arts is a way of giving not as much as not being the only patron, but being a bunch of patrons that jointly can come together and support an artist that you like. So other micro donations. Does anyone else have an example of a micro donation service?
It's not really micro donation. Kind of mix between micro donations and Patreon, but the idea of royalties, of taxing the media, like in the old age, we taxed cassettes because we knew people were taping songs and hear it again. So this idea is still around. I, I think it's a bad idea because the question is how you distribute the taxing between the creators. But it's still around, and at least in the scholars still talk about it, about taxing the media, taxing the broadband, or if you have, you buy an artist, you pay amount of money, and that goes to some fund, and then someone will decide how to distribute it.
So the comment was that taxing, for example, broadband distributors to enable them to hand out this money to creators. And it's been suggested by many people, and I think it would work in some ways, but the big disadvantage is determining how you would be able to distribute this money to the different creators. And the only way is having complete information, which means you have to survey the users to see what are they using, what are they downloading, what are they listening to right now, which becomes very controversial if you want some privacy. And also in some ways we have this kind of taxing and collecting agency in the, what are we called, music publishers, the collecting agencies that collect for example,
producers,
that you're allowed.
Producers, music producers.
Not the producers, but there's always an agency in each country that collects music that if you're going to play something live.
Collecting societies.
Collecting societies, thank you. Collecting societies does a similar work as one. That they collect the money and then they distribute it. Unfortunately, this works in some ways for bigger, more famous artists, and smaller artists get a very small amount of this cake. And as seen, the problem is also the cost that these collecting agencies acquire, and a bit of corruption within these collecting societies as well. For example, there's been big scandals in the collecting society in Spain, SGAE, which have been briberies and money disappearing. There's been similar cases in Sweden, I'm sure several other countries as well. Iceland. So, success stories of micro donations. I'm gonna bring up three people that have been able to, or three organizations that have been able to use micro donations successfully. First one, at least Germans probably know him, is called Tim Pritlov, and he's very famous for his podcasting. He has a big podcast network. He's been using mainly Flutter in the past, and now he's using PayPal and a few other ways of collecting money as well. But as you can see, since I believe this is from 2011, he's been collecting 238,000 Flutters. And a Flutter click could be anywhere between 1.5 cents or 2 euros. Or it's hard to say exactly how much, but at least it shows that 8,696 people have been pleased enough with his work to be able to keep him going by doing a micro donation to him. And with this income, he's been receiving about 2,000 euros a month from Flutter income alone. And with this, he's been able to build up his studio, he's been able to make more podcasts, he's been able to help a lot. And the last income report I saw from him, he said about half of his income came from Flutter clicks. So half of his income is voluntary donations that say, you're a good artist, we want to keep you doing what you're doing. Second one is the founder of Patreon, called Jack Conte. He's been doing music videos, been releasing about one video each month. And Patreon works by pledging an amount. So it can be pledging an amount for a specific work, and it can be pledging an monthly amount, depends on how the artist puts it up. And as you can see, Jack Conte has been gathering fans, or patrons, as they're called, to pledge an amount per video. So right now, it says he has 1,361 patrons, and together they are donating $5,400 each time he creates a video. So that enables him to live off his work and be able to make more videos or make them with more effects or more to what he wants. So each time he knows he creates a video, he will receive the same time. And to keep his patrons, he has to keep the quality up of the video, of course, but keep producing what they want. The last example I will take up is called TAS. TAS is a left-wing newspaper in Germany, and they have been using Flatter and PayPal and direct donations and a few different. TAS is a bit special as a newspaper because it's a cooperative, so people might be willing to pay a bit more than for a normal newspaper. But it still shows that journalism can be done by people supporting them. So this is the amount that they have for their digital subscriptions, the digital content that they're producing. For the print content, they have other revenue. So in total, since 2011, they made 271,000 euros. This is a lot or not, it's hard to say, because newspaper organizations are a fairly big organization to run. But they seem quite pleased, at least, with the amount they're receiving monthly. So monthly they're making about 10,500 euros from people donating freely to content they like and to keep the newspaper producing articles. The recurring amount is more kind of subscription amount, that they're subscribing to content or they're pledging to donate, pledge to donate 10 euros every month. So the majority is coming from people that say each month I'm going to donate this much. But it also shows there's a lot of people donating once off as well, or just for content they like. From this, they got around, the last time, around 500 euros from Flatter donations. So just the Flatter click, a little super like button that people clicked once they liked an article, they got 500 euros. Which for a big newspaper organization is not a lot, but it adds up. So say many small streams form a large river, and that's the case with micro donations as well. So some challenges with micro-donations. The first challenge is reaching a critical mass. Reaching enough people to make it worthwhile for bigger content producers to invest their time, invest their energy. It's also on a global scale that gaining this critical mass to make enough people want to use the service to make it worthwhile. The second one is language. I know a lot of, at least the English-speaking world, believes the world runs in English. But there's a big population, for example, in Latin America, that are not comfortable using English. Or, for example, Germany too, especially when it comes to money handling. When it comes to donating and giving your money online, there's still a big issue with confidence. And that is magnified if it's not your native tongue. So being able to translate your service or your content to different languages is a key issue to make it more efficient and improve it. Also with money handling, it's a lot of legal issues, especially when it goes across different zones. Do you have a question?
Yeah.
I believe, especially as I'm quite active in the world of how to finance and how to get money flowing, especially for a pilot project. Maybe because I'm a Luxembourger, joke on me. I believe one of the key issues with money handling is not only the language of the websites where you have to pay, but also the accessibility of payment methods. If you are talking to a Spaniard, he will tell you that nobody there gets a Visa card. Yet, 98% of all the solutions that we have to get money flowing on the internet, cryptocurrencies aside, are based on having a credit card. If you can't get a credit card, not even a prepaid one, then you are out of the question, so you can't contribute on the net. So actually what we need to find is a way to get money flowing through the means that we already have, such as SEPA direct debit, which maybe the pirates could use as a platform to get money flowing also to artists without the need to having a credit card, without the need to having a credit score, but simply by means of having an account at a bank, which most people have, but still there are also people not having bank accounts. So how do we get money flowing? And that's a problem that's already asked and tried to be answered by Western Union, by PaySafe cards, and by a lot of more shady businesses. If we can't solve the problem to getting physical money into the digital realm, I don't see how we can have a system where content creators are being paid digitally, because simply there are a lot of people, and I'm not talking about the normal countries where we are always talking about the US, everybody has 2 to 6 credit cards, no problem. Most of the northern European countries, everybody has a credit card. They're giving them away at the age of 18. But those that don't have those credit cards, don't have access to payment methods, how can they contribute if they are willing to, which I think most are, how can they contribute to paying for art, paying for content, paying for information? And I believe that's the biggest hurdle, and not language or legal issues, because legal issues, hire a good lawyer and it can be solved. The problem is, how can I get people to use a service that currently they can't use?
Yeah, definitely. That's, I know one other problem that Flutter had as well, is how do you get money into a system? There has been some methods, but it hasn't been easy methods. And one of the reasons there hasn't been that easy methods, that you can, for example, take money from your bank account and direct debit it into your Flutter account and give to content creators, is legal reasons. So in some ways it comes back to legal issues, in some ways it comes back to legal institutions that make it harder to make a freer flow of money. Especially when it comes to crossing borders with money, it becomes more complicated. But as you mentioned, getting money into a system and getting money out of a system is a very important aspect as well. The last point I will take up is valuing the work. And as a challenge, because how much is this worth? And it's not as easy as you first believe. How much is this blog post that I just read? How much is that worth to me? Is it worth 5 cents? Is it worth 2 euros? How much work did the author put into it? Should it be paid per hour? So doing a micro donation is not just clicking and saying, this is worth 5 cents. It's a cognitive exercise determining how much am I willing to pay for this piece of work. One way that, for example, Flutter is solving this is that they have a pie each month. Each month you say, I'm going to pay 10 euros. And then this 10 euros is divided on who you like during the month, and then split up into equal parts. So determining exactly how much is it worth is very hard. So a small summary of my presentation. My problem that I identified is that culture is a bit more prevalent. Everyone is a creator, so it becomes a lot more culture. We consume a lot more culture. We, not like in the past, that we watch 1-2 movies a month. We maybe watch 1-2 movies a day for some people. So being able to pay for all of that, we can't really do. So that's why we kind of need micro donations as well, splitting it up in enough small parts, and then once a work is popular enough, you get enough money. The premise is the micro donations is one future possibilities of paying for some of the work. I'm not saying it's the only solution, I'm saying it's one of the complementary solutions to providing an income for the artist. So what I'm saying is the solution is decentralizing the funding and finding more methods and coming closer to the people. So you out here, has anyone used micro donations? A few. Well, what have you used then? Did you have any problems or how did it feel?
Just PayPal, simple.
PayPal? Hmm? Flutter? Did you find it hard to use micro donations or was it? Yeah. Yeah, so it's a bit hard to set up.
No, especially if that has one problem. You can get money without that you have an account. And getting that money out,
yeah,
almost impossible.
So
we tried for 6 months to get those €2.50 out. Because we had to declare them legally, we were obliged to declare them to the government. And at the end, we told them, simply write us a bill for €2.50. Take the money, keep it.
So the problem experienced there was you can receive money through some of the services, for example Flutter, without having an account. So here they receive €2.50 and they wanted to take it out, but then they have to do some legal stuff, which becomes more complicated than it worked. And that comes back to the one of the challenge parts, that reaching this critical mass. If it was €100, it wouldn't be such a problem. So, thanks. I'm Josef Ohlsson, Collentine. Some contact information. Any questions?
Thank you for this bit of what we need to do in order to tackle the big copyright monster. So you see this, are there any other, sort of have there been done any proper studies into this? I think maybe it would be very useful to have a university to do a proper study and report on solutions, because there are obvious hurdles. Has that been done yet?
There has been some studies, there hasn't been so much, enough studies, I would say. And most of the studies are still concerned with donations, for example, for the Red Cross or for similar organizations. So there has been plenty of studies done in that area, but not so much for individual creators.
Just one more thing in this regard, because I'm working in a sort of a European project called Decent, and one of the parts that we are trying to implement is cryptocurrency micro donations. I don't know how far they've gone with it, it's sort of we're in the middle of it. But I think it is critical for those of us that want to try to change the way money flows, is to get, and that just I want to compliment the fact that we are in a university that focuses on commerce, And we need to get more academia on board to do deeper studies, and also we need experimentation. Flutter is an experiment in that regard. It's not. It's a beautiful idea. I love Flutter. It's just it needs more experimentation and more users. So, do you have any solutions on how to reach that critical mass?
One thing that I mentioned is those challenges. So it's a lot about overcoming challenges. For example, communicating more around what is it that we're doing. And a lot of the successful examples that I brought up, Tim Pritlove and Jack Conte, they have the advantage that they already have this massive following that appreciate the product, and then they're able to enable the microdonations. It's very hard to get into microdonations unless you have a following already and be successful. But getting more institutions into it, I don't have any good suggestions or ideas. But I would say it's coming more and more with technology and seeing examples. And for example, another thing that's not directly microdonation, you could say microdonation is called Pennies, which is a foundation that is present in England. And what they have done is that they've gone out to several businesses, for example, Domino's Pizza, and said, could you add this donation feature to your product? So it's directly interacting with the businesses to add a donation feature. And with Pennies, what they do is they round up. So instead of paying $19.97 for a pizza, you pay 20 euros. And these 3 cents, they go to donations. So by enabling those small 3 cents, and a lot of customers say 3 cents, why not? I want to do something good with them. And by adding mass, they've achieved a lot. By reaching this critical mass, by reaching out to the right kind of organizations and reaching out to their clients. So it's a lot about reaching these networks that have a larger reach than you yourself might have.
And another thing maybe about accepting cryptocurrencies as donations, be always aware of the legal implications. Because in most jurisdictions, you actually need to know who gave you money. Knowing who gave you money is quite difficult if you have an anonymous payment system. So also there, and I agree completely with you, that we need more research into how to use those systems. So how can we be compliant by using bitcoins? How can we be compliant by using almost any digital cryptocurrency that exists? There are nowadays gateways that enable us to be compliant, but the research in comparing them, in giving exact statements, this is acceptable for that type of entities, this is not acceptable, has yet to be done. And especially regarding cryptocurrencies, the research currently focuses too much on how they work instead of how they can be used. So we are looking into how does the blockchain work? Is the S-Crypt or SHA-256 more efficient, better to protect the blockchain? How can we tamper-proof the system? Instead of saying, well, most parties or most groups don't care whether those payments are tamper-proof. They simply want to know, can I receive a donation with the system? And if so, how should I use it? So I believe that you're completely right in pointing out we are lacking a lot of aggregation. So there is still, it's like the Wild West. It's not aggregated at all. And this is work that should be done. And I'm seeing first steps also in the academia addressing the issue, but still a lot to be done. And maybe at some point we simply need to say, okay, well, we will order a study ourselves. Or maybe we will give some intern the chance to do a study during his internship. And as long as we that are here are not willing to sacrifice the work hours of an intern, it will not happen. Because nobody else currently cares. And that's something we should always remember. If we want those studies to be done, better do them ourselves or give them to somebody that we know that can do them.
I think one of the things with doing more academic studies is the chicken and egg problem. That to have an interest from academics, you have to reach a certain critical mass. And once you reach this critical mass, then people will want to do studies automatically.
Exactly.
So overcoming the problems, making the product simple enough, so it's really easy to use, then you will reach the critical mass, and then the studies will come. More questions?
Yeah, actually I have two questions. First was really simple. May I borrow your presentation for educational purposes?
Of course.
Thanks.
Creative Commons.
I thought so, but it didn't say anywhere. The other question is, we always hear about microdonations as kind of the solution to how to use Creative Commons, but are there any other examples of solutions that we can kind of point out?
Can you evolve the question? More solutions than Creative Commons?
Yeah. No, like to how to use Creative Commons, because we, as pirates, we go on about copyright reform and then we mention Creative Commons and then sharing or giving away and then making people pay or asking them to pay instead of forcing them to pay. And the only example of how you do that usually is micro donations, but are there any other methods?
Other methods of getting funding?
Yeah.
As I mentioned, micro donations doesn't rule out traditional methods. For example, merchandise, for example, direct donations through PayPal, that could be more substantial, getting grants, getting organizations that are involved. So I'm just presenting one possibility of extending this kind of funding. So finding one solution is very hard to.
I've been looking for more solutions because we always focus on the micro donations. But it's good to hear that we may also present other solutions.
Yeah, it's a very good point. I think there are in some countries, at least, in various countries, there are state-run grants that or support for, in particular, the cutting-edge artists. And so I guess we're dealing with two or three different scenarios. We're dealing with people that will never be rich and can never actually live off their art. They need support. And then you have the commercial art. And these are very different categories. And I've heard of so many different success stories from artists that, you know, including myself, like when I started to use the internet in 95 to publish my poetry, I got all sorts of offers to go and participate in international festivals that would have never been possible. So my horizon and possibility to outreach was much greater. I think one of the greatest, and coming from the artist background myself, and owning copyright to my mom's music, which I gave away in a foundation because I don't want it, it would have been so great if she could be paid properly when she lived. Shorter copyright periods are critical if we want to help artists live on their art, get paid more for the stuff so they can create more. And that, while we still have these sort of foundations that collect the money for the artists, and all these different unions that artists are part of, I quit my union, my writers union, because it's so crappy. And does not do anything to protect or encourage any sort of rights for me. It is just for the top layer. And so it's a cultural thing within each country. It is not, there is not one model that fits all. But the biggest, I think, and the greatest achievement we could get is to shortening the copyright time. and to get more artists to use CC, because that will enable them to reach more. Everybody knows that I've used that sort of system. So I just want to put that into the equation. There is no one solution. This is an ongoing process in development. And of course, microdonations are just one little bit of it.
Yeah. Going back to the last question as well, I came up with one example. Is using new technology in an innovative way, for example, book publishing. It was always the publishers, you give your book to the publisher publishes your book, you get the money. But now, with technology, you can publish your own books as well. And through, for example, Amazon, you can promote your book, you can find your own funding, following, and you can make money through that. So it's a way of going around these big things. Same goes for music, using, for example, a site called Bandcamp, which supports artists a lot, is that you can publish your own music instead. So using new technologies could be one way of getting around the funding problem as well. More questions? Microphone.
First of all, Josef, thank you very much. It was a very inspiring presentation. But I want to know your own ideas about this method. And I hope against capitalism. This kind of new technologies push the limits of capitalist system, legally, culturally, economically. But as far as I listened to this method, we try to fit this method into existing legal system or economic system. We are trying to integrate this new system to an old system. It may be my bad idea, but what's your own idea about this?
Definitely. We're definitely, as I mentioned, this is a way of hacking the existing system. It's a way of providing alternatives, building up your own following, getting more direct contacts with your fan, getting your fans to support you more directly instead of the copyright that took out mediary route. But getting a completely different solution is more about reforming the copyright, which Julia will talk more about tomorrow. So that requires a bigger effort, and it's not such a direct approach. The direct approach that we can use today is by going around hacking copyright and enabling other alternatives. Another question?
Well, one of the measures to further foster this type of microdonations is open source platforms. I'm involved in an organization called International Young Professionals Foundation, and we built cooperatives worldwide based on open source networks. So each of these cooperatives has you know, the code that they could use to make their own model. And a similar model to micro donations is called the Innovations Hub, that people can contribute not only funding but also other resources, maybe materials or even human force or contacts they have. So I was wondering if you thought of a way how these all different platforms could be brought together in a way to exchange the know-how between them, but also for users to know that, for example, I have all these different opportunities and I could use them depending on my interests or on my available funds. Is there a way that pirates could somehow come up with a hub collecting all those and promoting them? Thank you.
So, good question. I think, as I mentioned, one of the key things is decentralization. So I don't believe in one solution that fits everything. I believe in a lot of different solutions. And with the information age that we have today, it's a lot of information. That means we rely on curators. People coming together and gathering, this is good, and putting them together and making a list or making a blog or making a third service that is, aggregates this. And as you mentioned, the innovation hub sounds a bit like that. It gathers these different types of services. So I believe more curation, which is definitely something we could do, just listing up these alternatives you have. Here you can get some funding if you have this kind of project. Any more questions?
Is there any more questions? Thank you for Josef, your great presentation. Coffee break, 15 minutes.
As mentioned, we will be hearing from five speakers for today. Our next speaker is Mr. Smári. I want to him for his speech.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to try to walk you through this crazy idea that came up in a conversation in a cafe about a year ago. And it might solve a problem that hasn't previously been solved. So this is going to be slightly mathematical, but I'm going to try and make it not hurt too much. And if you follow the reasoning, you that's the important thing. The mathematics doesn't really matter. And actually, I'm hiding most of the horrendous details just because, well, partially there's no whiteboard, but also I don't want to bore you to death. So this question of voting mostly comes down to a thing called social choice theory. And voting as an activity just doesn't have any simple rules. Since the Marquis de Condorcet discovered the voting paradox about 200 odd years ago, various people have been kind of digging down into the problem of how we collectively make decisions and found an overwhelming supply of interesting problems. So at the core of it, there's this concept of social welfare functions, which is kind of the weird economics term for how you make a collective decision. And so voting being kind of one of the central activities in democracy, it's kind of the way in which democratic societies arrive at collective decisions. But it's not a constant, well-defined concept. There's all sorts of variations, as you know. And some of the variations are good, others are bad. And the method of decision-making basically reduces down to this question of a balloting method and a way of calculating the result, which is the social welfare function. Here I listed a couple. These are more kind of economic style than typical of voting because, well, partially the interesting voting methods are a bit too complicated to fit on a slide. How social welfare is calculated basically becomes a matter of taste. It's not something that there's an actual good result for or actual, there's no theory of what is the best voting system. And, basically there's no one-size-fits-all method, and the same is true of voting in general. So just to illustrate that point, here's a bunch of kind of examples of majoritarian voting systems. So at the top, first past the post, which is possibly the worst voting system ever, and it's used quite widely. It's used in the UK, or England at least, used in the US Congress and in India, and it's basically winner takes all. So whoever gets the plurality in the vote, so not necessarily a majority, being over half of the votes, but just more votes than the next person or than all of the other candidates wins. Then, going down, there's all sorts of other systems. You'll recognize some of them. The board account is a particularly fun one. It's used in the Eurovision Song Contest and is interesting in that it tends to promote mediocrity, which if you've watched that contest, you'll understand. So there's a bunch of other systems. There's the proportional representation systems, like the party list proportional systems that are used in most of the Nordic countries, in Israel, and quite a lot of places. And single transferable vote, like, is used in Scotland and Ireland, and a few other places. And then there's mixed systems, which there's lots of systems. That's the main thing. And actually, just to illustrate a further point, some systems are single winner systems where there's only one outcome winner, whereas proportional systems tend to be multi winner systems, and you can see like how that all comes down. But one of the interesting things that happens when you start looking at all of these voting systems is, when you're comparing them, you're comparing properties. You really only care, like, what does it give you? What does what kind of outcomes are likely to occur? And of course, that means that the decision of what voting system to use is an ultimately political decision, more so than a systemic decision. So this guy's Kenneth Arrow. He's one of the kind of economists who had sat down and started to look at what kind of outcomes or properties you might find in voting systems. And one of the things he came up with was what's known as Arrow's impossibility theorem, which states that these four properties, so non-dictatorship, obviously, if you have a dictatorship system, then regardless of what people actually vote for, the winner is always going to be the same. Unrestricted domain more or less reduces down to anybody, so there's no a priori restrictions on what candidates can run or what choices people can make. Independence of irrelevant alternatives means that to use Arrow's example, if you have three candidates and all of the votes have been cast and then one of them dies, then the fact that candidate died shouldn't actually affect the outcome of the vote. If it does, then the entire system is unstable in an interesting way. And the last one is Pareto efficiency, which mostly just means that everybody is getting maximum value out of the vote, or it is as good as can be without... if there was any further benefit for one person, it would mean a greater loss for somebody else. And the interesting thing of Arrow's impossibility theorem is that you cannot have all four of these properties. They're all really, really important, but in the case where you have a ranked voting method, so where you choose one or choose a ordering of the candidates, if there are more than two candidates, so three or more, then you cannot have all of these features. And that poses an interesting problem. And there are other problems like this in voting theory, like the Gibbard-Satterthwaite theorem or the Duggan-Schwarz theorem or various others. But this is just to illustrate the point that there are a lot of weird features that we care about. So moving on to the question of voting processes. First off, what is electronic voting and what is it not? So I'm going to talk about electronic voting to mean voting in which there's a formal automatic method of calculating ballot results. So while this would probably be more accurately described as machine voting rather than electronic voting, I'd like to separate out and highlight the case where, this is an old American machine, where a machine is used to collect the ballot, but that's different from where the machine is used to count the ballots. So here we get into the formalism. In order to have a voting system, you need essentially a balloting method, as I mentioned, which is just a way of collecting the votes. Most of the time, this is a piece of paper with checkboxes, right? But the nature of the piece of paper, how many boxes there are, what kind of sequences, and so on, that all matters. And F is the social welfare function. That's just a way we take the votes and calculate the outcome. And C is a set of choices, so it's basically all of the names of the candidates or something like that. And then in order to generate the votes, we use the balloting method on all of the people. So this basically means that everybody comes and votes. And there's a set of external factors that kind of matters. So sometimes, such as in single transferable vote, where you basically order all of the candidates that you want in the order that you like them, there's a certain random factor that is used. And if that random factor is not predetermined, but rather calculated each time, then you have a situation where it's actually impossible to recreate the same results after, so if there's a recount, then the recount is used with a completely different random seed and everything goes nuts. And then, we get the set of votes out. So to calculate the result, you just use the social welfare function on the votes and get out the social choice. So if we lay it out a little bit, so we define the voting system, we define all the external factors, we provide the ballots to the voter, and the ballot is cast, so the voter puts the ballot into the ballot box. The votes are all collected together, they're counted, and then the result is announced, and you can see how all of the little variables kind of carry on through the entire thing. So voting system security is, security is a contextual and very frequently overloaded term. It's the factors that are determining the security of a system are dependent on the threats that are assumed to exist towards the system and the vectors available to an attacker to make good of those threats. So when dealing with voting systems, we generally want to guarantee that there are several independent aspects with regard to the security. So we generally want to guarantee these properties. We want a voting system that is non-falsifiable, meaning that you cannot come after the fact and say that somebody tampered with the ballot. You want to make sure that it is possible to calculate the result. It would suck, and it does sometimes happen with various voting systems that you just can't get a result. The Condorcet method is particularly good at providing non-results in certain cases. You need the result calculations to be stable, meaning that they don't flop around with the same vote. So you have the same votes, the same candidates, then you should always get the same output or same winners, right? It would be really bad if that changed each time you calculated. And then a voter should not be, it shouldn't be possible to coerce a voter into making a particular choice. So let's go into each one of these in a bit more detail. So a voting system is stable if the votes alone are sufficient to calculate the result. And all of the external factors that at the time of counting don't actually affect the outcome of the results. So if two people start counting or calculating the outcome from the same set of ballots using the same method at different times and derive at a different result, then the system's considered unstable. And as I said, many voting systems have instability as one of their one of their features, essentially. So some people would say that random resolution doesn't really reflect social choice, but it really means that the social welfare function is being employed to determine the results. If the social welfare function is being used to determine the results, doesn't ask the voters for enough information to come to a conclusion, then randomness is kind of needed to sort things out. And the main thing is that two independent actors, given the ballots, given the voting system, may arrive at different results that's just not good. So, and partially because if we wanted to independently verify the outcome, the official outcome, and we get all of the votes and start counting again, you know, everything gets calculated incorrectly. So, enforcing the stability feature basically gives us a bit of security on two of these. So, the external factors are determined and nailed down, and published preferably. And then the votes are counted in a way that anybody can do so. Now, calculability it's probably the simplest of these conditions, I guess. A voting system is calculable if, given a set of social choices and a social welfare function, a result can be calculated. So, under the conditions that Arrow gave us, calculability is guaranteed if the social welfare function has an unrestricted domain. It's possible, however, that a social welfare function which does not have an unrestricted domain may be used in a voting system that is nevertheless calculable. Right? So one guarantees it, but its absence doesn't necessarily exclude it. And this form of restriction. If you make certain restrictions on the balloting method, on the balloting method, then you can actually force a thing to be calculable, which is kind of nice, and that's normally called a limitation on the admissible set. And you all follow this probably. Okay. So. And that requirement guarantees that if the ballot is cast, you know, it's cast correctly, and votes are actually countable, and you know, you can actually calculate things. So non-falsifiability is the property that after each social choice is made by a person, that choice cannot be altered by a third party. And the condition is met if it can be guaranteed that every social choice is an input to the social welfare function. So, while mathematically this doesn't sound like a difficult condition, in practice it's really the hardest to guarantee. So, in traditional pencil paper voting, where you know the pathway that the ballot takes from the voter in voting booth to the point where it's counted, and the result subsequently from there to the point where it's made public knowledge, is riddled with all sorts of vulnerable points. So amongst these are vulnerabilities of an exclusion of a legitimate voter from the ballot. So somebody who's allowed to vote can't vote because somebody kind of removed their name from the list or something like that. This happens a lot in the US. So a third party illegitimately creating and entering ballots on behalf of another voter, or a third party adding illegitimate votes to the set, so putting fake votes into the ballot box, and so on and so forth. You can imagine there's a bunch of different situations here. So actually the way we normally deal with this is to try and make the entire thing just work by putting in enough people into the system that you know, and everybody is equally mistrustful of each other, that you get to a point of saturation where most of the people, at least everybody who matters, says, well, okay, there's very little chance of anybody being able to falsify the vote, rig the vote, whatever, steal the election. This isn't actually non-falsifiable. It's just very close to probabilistically, and I call this Byzantine validity. So people are adding what Byzantine fault tolerance to the system, and so it shouldn't be assumed to be non-falsifiable. And there's no explicit way to prove after the fact that there's no tampering occurred. And that's really the crux of it. So, you know, we do the election, somebody comes afterwards and says, you know, I believe that 5,000 of these votes were fake, and nobody can prove whether that's true or not. And that's a problem. So, And, you know, the formulation of this is kind of complicated. There's really four active moments. There's the initialization where the validity method and social welfare function and the set of voters are defined. So somebody could come in and set up a situation there that causes a condition of dictatorship. Or pre-balloting, where the choice set and the external factors are defined, somebody could come up with some choice set that only that steals a vote. Or balloting, where the votes are actually created, or post-balloting, and that's kind of where it comes down to. And then non-coercion. So this is basically the one where you cannot force me to vote for something. And just to give an example of where that becomes a problem, there's a hack that I was told of that's used sometimes in Bulgaria, that somebody will go into voting booth and get a vote, but not actually hand it in one way or another. Then they come out and with a blank vote, and they see somebody who's coming in. They say they fill out the vote with what they want them to vote for, and give it to the voter, and say, "Come out with a blank vote, otherwise, violence will occur." So the voter goes in, gets a blank vote, goes into the polling booth, hides the blank vote, comes back out, and puts the pre-filled vote into the box. And then comes out to the threatening guy and hands him a blank vote, and and that way he has another blank vote to threaten the next person and so on and so forth. It's kind of an interesting coercion mechanism. So we generally regard coercion as a negative impact on the voting system, as it eliminates a legitimate voter's choice from the social choice set. And replaces it with a fraudulent social choice, and it's kind of equivalent to falsification, but it's a little bit more nuanced than that. It happens prior to the balloting action by the given person, and is therefore undetectable by anything that that can. Non-falsifiability does not guarantee that coercion didn't happen. So. So a solution to this, kind of the most simple solution to this, is allow voters to cast multiple votes, with each subsequent vote annulling the previous vote. Now, you can't really accomplish that in pencil paper voting without actually linking the votes to the voter. And that's kind of where the problem starts to come up. So. It also becomes very messy at scale. If you're processing millions of ballots and you have to manually check each ballot for whether it's been eliminated, and need to be very careful not to eliminate something that isn't supposed to be eliminated. If you're doing it using normal pencil paper counting methods, that's going to fail very bad very fast. Electronic voting makes this a lot easier. So, yet there is the possibility remaining that a person's coerced to vote and then is eliminated, killed, before they can fix it. So somebody comes to you and say, "You were supposed to vote for this guy, I cast the vote," and then they kill me so that I can't go and change my vote afterwards. Now, that's a hard situation to deal with. One way to maybe deal with that is that after all the votes are cast, before all of the counting happens, anybody who died, their votes are removed from the set. But then you actually have to have a method of figuring out who cast each vote, and that's a problem. So, to add one last point of complexity to this, the ability to replace votes implies the ability to identify the votes to the voters, which may also be the basis of schemes leading to violence. So you're trying to prevent violence from happening by putting in those extra rules, but in doing so you're identifying people, so minorities can be kind of forced to not have certain opinions, or at least not publicly, and so on. So we need to have both simultaneously this ability to not have a coercive system and have the ability to verify the system and not be able to link the votes back to the person who cast it. And that brings us to the unlinkability paradox. So traditional voting schemes assume that non-coercion is achieved by enforcing that voters alone in a regulated booth, and that from the point in time when the voter enters the ballot into the ballot box, the ballot is anonymous. Now, that doesn't necessarily hold true. Depending on the design of the ballot box, the design of the ballot, the conditions in the polling station, it's always possible to violate that assumption, and the fact that everybody has mobile phones now with cameras and such, despite the fact that cameras are notionally banned in most polling stations, that doesn't actually matter because, people aren't leaving their phones behind when they enter. A person can basically be coerced into privately taking a picture of their ballot to show that they've demonstrate compliance. And often, ballots are marked in some way to guarantee authenticity and uniqueness, or to indicate origin, but that too can be used to violate voter anonymity, or at least substantially reduce the set of possible voters who could have cast that particular vote, right? So these assumptions, apart from not being sufficient to guarantee anonymity, are in a sense trying to solve the wrong problem. Because the issue isn't specifically anonymity, whether or not the identity of the voter can be obscured, but rather the special case of whether the ballot or social choice can be linked back to the particular voter. So this is a special case of anonymity that I call unlinkability. And formally, that's kind of the construction. I just thought that was funny. Put simply, if the exclusion of a vote from the set of votes is sufficient for the identification of the voter, then the voter can be identified. And that's all that needs to be done, as far as I can tell, in order to make sure. If we can guarantee that there is no such function, that kind of eliminating one vote from the set allows you to figure out who he is, who cast that vote, then we're good. That's enough for getting the unlinkability. But all of these security properties that I've been defining, they're in fact conditions of verifiability, right? Without them, it's impossible to independently verify the outcome of the election. And that can be done, it can be done generally to a substantial degree while violating some of the conditions. For instance, with the Byzantine verifiability concept, which in practice is simply the act of adding more people, with different interests and so on, until everybody's happy. But verifiability requires non-coercion, and non-coercion requires simultaneously that votes can be recast in a way that invalidates previous votes, and that votes cannot be linked back to the voter who cast them. So we're faced with this interesting scenario that verifiability and unlinkability cannot exist simultaneously. They have never coexisted in any voting system so far. That's a bit of a problem. That's really scary. That means that you cannot have a voting an election that is provably true and anonymous at the same time. So, let just understand the importance of that. Traditionally, you're casting a ballot in a normal voting system, and the vote being cast is generally, outside of exceptional circumstances, not linkable to the person who cast it. And assuming that all has gone well up until this point in time, the voter now believes that the vote will be included in the determination of who the winner is. And most of the time that's true. But as long as at least one vote with an identical value that chosen by the voter is included, the voter cannot independently verify that the vote has been included. That's just a huge problem, right? So one way to try and solve this might be to add more information, right? So if you've got a bunch of choices, say there's four choices, right? Then there's a statistical probability that if you have b to the power of, no, 2 to the power of 4 divided by 2 individuals, they could, so voters that are voting, then they could be able to identify their ballots statistically. But that means that if you've got a population of, say, 16 million people, then suddenly you're in a situation where you need to have about 16 different candidates in order for, no, sorry, you need about 16 million candidates in order for each person to be able to identify their vote without that violating the anonymity problem. So generally, if you want to add information to the ballots in order to solve this problem, then you need to have the number of options equal to the number of size of the population, and that just doesn't work in practice. So here's the idea: money laundering. So you are familiar with the blockchain mechanism, right? It's basically developed for Bitcoin. I have some complaints about Bitcoin. It isn't great, but the idea of the blockchain is really good. It's really just a cryptographically verifiable distributed append-only log. Anybody can add an entry, nobody has full control over the log, and anybody can verify that the log has not been tampered with. And that gives us a basis for an interesting feature. But we need something else. The blockchain alone is not good enough. So another useful mechanism is a type of mathematical proof called a zero-knowledge proof. So it allows for the verification of a statement without there being any information exchange. And that sounds weird, but it turns out to be true. So for Bitcoin, there's an extension been suggested called ZeroCoin, which strongly anonymizes cryptographic tokens. And this is pretty much the same thing as money laundry. You have a bunch of anonymous tokens, and you exchange them randomly with people, an older, kind of less provable version of this is mixing networks, so like Mixmaster. So they're mixed or interchanged randomly in unpredictable ways, each time mediated through a zero-knowledge proof to ensure that there's no paper trail left behind, right? So this gives us a concept of drive token verifiability. So using these two mechanisms, we can create a voting system like so. Each eligible voter gets, by some mechanism, a unique cryptographic token. For instance, set of points on the curve or whatever, some keys, something cool. And whatever their token is, this is signed by the electoral authority. And the electoral authority publishes the voter roster, so a list of everybody who's allowed to vote, and their signature. So saying, this is how everybody who can vote will have a thing that is signed with our key. Or rather, so they publish their key. Then voters use a mechanism similar to ZeroCoin to launder the voting tokens, rendering them unidentifiable and even to the voting or electoral authority. And then voters use the newly laundered anonymous tokens to sign their votes and append them to the blockchain. Right. So that means that when a vote has been cast, it is possible to say, that was you. But at the same time, no, you've actually been engaged in this mixing network, and there's no way to actually prove that that was you. It was as likely to have been anybody else. So this is actually the same thing as adding more bitrate to the ballot, except it's happening not in the choices, it's happening in the externalities behind it, right? And so it's possible to verify that every vote belongs to a legitimate person, but impossible to say who, unless the private part of that person's key is published. And if a voter casts multiple votes, then there will be multiple votes signed with the same key. In that case, the most recent vote can be considered valid and all of older votes discarded. So essentially this mechanism fulfills in theory, you know, both requirements for unlinkability and verifiability. Cool, eh? Now, you know, just to go through the things, anybody can verify in this system that the system specifications, including the balloting method, the social welfare function, the set of ballot options, the set of voters, they're all published at the beginning of the blockchain. And then the random, you know, the random seed or external factors, that's also published at the beginning of the blockchain. So a rule could be instated to say that E, you know, our various random parameters cannot be altered after the first vote has been appended. Then a voter cannot repudiate her vote because there's no way to prove which vote was hers except exposing the public key, the private key. And the user cannot be coerced into voting as they can always alter the vote. And private voting tokens of deceased voters can be published in full, meaning that the votes get marked as duds, right? So that prevents the killing people solution to voter fraud. And yeah, so it is pretty easy to see how this system so far works with pretty much any generic voting system, right? However, in order to support liquid democracy style vote delegation, proxying, we need to add a little bit of more complication in the form of derived keys. So a voter can generate a new derived key from their own key, which is linked to their key, but because of the mixing network, that doesn't matter. And then, you know, they use that to delegate. And that person here, so they basically hand that person the key, probably using something like a diffie-hellman or something like that. And then that person can go and vote on say my behalf. But if at any point I want to pull the voting rights back, I just need to use my parent key to issue a revocation certificate for the derived key. So the problem here is that only works if we can construct a key derivation scheme that has these properties, and that's not proven. There's no guarantee that that's actually possible. But yeah, so I'm pretty certain that this theory pans out. The mechanism hasn't been built or prototyped. And further, there's some ideas in this that haven't been mathematically proven. But you know, I'm presenting this with the caveat that it is a conjecture. It's you know, it shouldn't be too difficult to prove comprehensively and you know, or to build a prototype. I just I haven't been able to, partially because I'm just not smart enough, but also partially because I don't have time, or haven't had time yet. But I'm pretty sure, I believe that a successful implementation of this mechanism would, you know, would open up a whole new set of interesting ways of thinking about voting as well, you know, and making it easy for people to participate in democracy. And, you know, one of the things, I mentioned electoral authorities a couple of times, but there's no reason why the electoral authority itself couldn't just be another blockchain. Because, you know, voting who is in your society is one of the ways of solving it, although that also has some political difficulties and not necessarily a good idea. But yeah, that's kind of it, so I'll leave it at that. Thanks. Probably no questions?
Yeah.
Question?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, apparently we couldn't keep the votes insecure, I guess, with the blank voting papers. For example, for my country, it happened in the last elections. So here are some questions. Technology will give so many chances to manipulate the manipulate these votes in that countries like us?
Mm-hmm.
And another one, what should be the solution to make the democracy more stronger in that countries with high populations like us? We have got 8 million people. And what about the violating the transparency in that point? And also, isn't it helping to create a more effective panoptic dictatorial system? Thank you.
Right. So that's really the whole point of this is currently you cannot build any electronic voting system that has either of these properties, right? Or nobody has done so. Normal pencil paper voting systems normally are not verifiable, but electronic voting systems so far have been neither verifiable nor anonymous, which is a big, big problem. And you know, therefore, I've said, you know, don't use electronic voting systems for anything where anonymity really matters or could matter, or for things where there isn't sufficient trust. So using it as an internal voting system for a political party might be okay most of the time, but there are edge cases where things would need to be pulled out and taken to a kind of referendum inside the party or in the society or club or whatever school, you know. But part of the reason for doing this is that if we can actually build a system which provides us both with this anonymity feature and the verifiability feature, it means that it is actually possible to verify, you know, in an unarguable way that no falsification has happened, that the entire thing is fair and untampered with. And that's really powerful. The other thing is, if we can at the same time guarantee anonymity, then boom, we've just gotten the two biggest things, the kind of holy grail of democracy, both at the same time, you know, and we've done it, you know, and that's never happened before. So I the proposition here is, I think this works. All of the kind of, you know, experimentation I've done on paper and you know, hammering at this for, you know, every now and then for about a year, convinces me that this might just work. And if it does, then hell cool, you know, that's, you know, problem solved.
I would like to ask you about the possibility of the token system, especially when you have a huge percentage of the voters that are illiterate.
Yeah.
And this is a case with a huge percentage of the population in Bulgaria, Romania, particularly the Romas, that parties easy to control. They literally put them in queues, and also the people that are in these committees that take the ballots are people, for example, from the social security systems or so on. So they would know that if this particular voter does not cast their vote,
mm-hmm.
they wouldn't get their social security and
right.
so on. So, and another point to mention, the token system is also effectively used in what's called e-invoice taxation. It was introduced by Professor Elmont Richmond from Harvard.
Mm-hmm.
So it is already a success.
Yeah.
It's a matter of time to be implemented in voting.
But there's no requirement of anonymity in that system.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. So as to the point of, you know, yes, illiteracy is a big problem for democracy. It means that people can't make enlightened decisions and can be cheated and so on and so forth. Rather than trying to make the voting system better, I think it's easier just to teach people to read. You know, I mean, not conflate the two problems and make them into the same thing. You know, the other thing is, yes, okay, using this kind of technological method comes with problems. Everybody understands a piece of paper, or so they think, right? You know, when you mark into a box, If you don't actually know how the thing is calculated, how it's counted, then that basically cripples your ability to vote strategically. If you put the ballot into the ballot box with full trust that the system works, if you don't understand the mechanics of how it works all the way through the chain, then you can't know how it's going to fail or how it could fail. And right now, people always say, or frequently say, hey, electronic voting is bad because people can't read code. But frankly, most people don't understand how voting systems work anyway, so why should we make that a limitation, right? On the other hand, there should be certain requirements there. The code should be free and open, anybody can run it on their own hardware, etc., etc. And by having it a blockchain, suddenly some of the cool, things come out of the hat, meaning, it's possible for everybody to go and independently download the entire blockchain and say, well, this computes correctly as to the official version on my computer, which I specially built in a Faraday cage and blah, 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 fulfill any paranoid considerations you might have. And that's really cool. Yeah. So I really don't think we should exclude things on the basis of illiteracy, whether that's normal illiteracy or technical illiteracy.
You mentioned voting systems where randomness was a normal part of the yeah. system. I was really surprised. Could you give some examples?
So two examples are the Scottish single transferable vote system and the Irish single transferable vote system. I will admit, I have not come across in the wild a voting system that is not single transferable vote that uses randomness. But basically, the way a single transferable vote works is you have all of the candidates in a pool. You see if anybody is a winner. If there is, then yay, and you add them to the winner list. If not, then you take the person, the candidate with the least votes, eliminate them, and then redistribute the ballots. So basically, calculate all the ballots again without that person included. And the randomness is used in single transferable vote in situations where you have to eliminate one candidate and you have two or three candidates that have the same, or however many number of candidates that have the same number of votes, and you eliminate one at random. And there, if the seed is not predetermined, then the elimination order can go out of whack and you get different results each time.
Basically, coin flip left or right.
Right, it's, I prefer pseudo-random number generators with predefined random seeds than coin flips or die tosses. Oddly, in the Icelandic Parliament, there is some process that's used where a fair die is stipulated by the, I think it's constitution rather than the rules of procedure. But something is decided, I can't remember what at the moment, do you remember? But something is decided by casting a fair die, and that means that you actually need to use dice, which is terrifying. But yeah.
In combination with this, there's our democracy world.
Yeah, randomness has been a factor in democracy, for a long time. It's, yeah. So, anybody? Yeah.
Okay, so you were saying that, just so I understand, that by using the token system that we've solved the riddle, or...
Maybe, yeah. So,
okay, so what do we need to do to test it? We need to do it in... one thing that I noticed, so some people talk about it's impossible to have... a functioning democracy in big countries,
right.
Whereas, I come from a tiny country, so do you, where if you live in a village, well, you're from the Westman Islands.
Oh, yeah, okay. An even tinier country.
In little villages, it is very easy to figure out who was what, because if the ruling party is no longer in power, there are some people to be blamed, and they will never get a job again.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's like we always.
That's actually a common thing in the town I come from. So
yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So. So I think that the problem, just like with everything, we always have to take into the perfect mathematical equation human nature and human behavior, and we can't erase it because humans are basically fucked up, many of them. So I think the most important, and I just want to hear your thoughts about it. I think, you know, doing the testing is very important. But also it is very important to evolve into a simpler terms for the general public the concept of liquid democracy. First of all, we need to change the name. It's just too geeky and nobody understands it. So active votes or something that's sort of that ordinary people can understand. And
we
need
to just
sort
call
of
it democracy?
Yeah, I mean, but it's like, you know, we are, it is democracy, well, fuck,
yeah.
Democracy doesn't
yeah.
really exist, it's
right.
an illusion, so, as it is today. Anyway, so, these two questions.
Yeah, so, I fully agree on the issue of humans being somewhat fucked up. You know, it's, and really, you know, all of the mathematical purity of this won't change the fact that, you know, it will require a concerted effort by all of these variously fucked up humans to actually decide to use a system like this. And, you know, you build the best system in the world and nobody uses it, it's kind of pointless. So, you know, ultimately, whatever we do in democracy, yes, we can rant about the mathematics, we can get that down, nail it down really well, and I think we should do that, but we should also acknowledge the fact that there is a massive human element. In fact, there is an overriding human element, and that's also going to have to be dealt with. We need to evolve our democracy, educate people in democracy. It's kind of funny how nobody actually gets education, how their countries work in school. Like, or almost nowhere. If it happens anywhere, I haven't heard of it. Like, there's some thin vestige of it in the US, I know, but whatever. The other thing, you know, have we cracked it? I think so, yeah. Maybe, you know, if we can prove this, then boom, you know, it's a whole new world. So. Well, the thing we need to be able to do it is ideally some money to hire some people to sit down and either write out a formal proof, preferably, and also to build a prototype system. You know, we could always do this with volunteers working, you know, but really, volunteerism doesn't necessarily always generate the best results, and it would be good to get somebody focused on this, so, you know, get them €1 million or something. I'm sure there's some EU fund or something that's willing to put money to that. Then maybe we could hire, you know, 3-4 mathematicians for a year or so and see what comes out of it. Yeah.
Regarding the just before you said throwing a dice scares you in democracy. This is completely the opposite of what currently happens in the US. Where there's a growing movement saying that in order to combat all man-made problems with democracy, talking about corruption, selling of votes, whatever, could only be combated by having simple lottery votes. So actually, everybody, the Greeks did it for some time, to simply grab somebody out of the pot and say him and tell him, hey, you guy, you are now the new prime minister of I don't know where.
Right.
Yes, it scares me too, but then again, it scares me that much that it starts to look pretty interesting to at least consider adding some sort of randomness into election methods. In order to I'm coming from a small country too.
Yeah.
In order to eliminate all those risks linked to having to vote in an election office where only 20 or 30 people are voting, so that everybody knows if there's one ballot with pirate on it,
mm-hmm.
of course that was swam.
Yeah.
And if there are two ballots with pirate on it, oh, and it must have been one of my friends.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
And for that, some randomness, I don't yeah. believe it's a bad thing.
And there is a bunch of research that suggests that that randomly chosen candidates often do better than career politicians or whatever, in both in terms of the quality of their decision making, but also the general feeling that people have for their decisions. And this is why, for instance, in the Icelandic Pirate Party, we have two seats in the board that are randomly selected, and you know, just to kind of add a little bit of random factor in there. It's an interesting thing. I think it's been working quite well. But there is still the danger that, you know, when we're talking about modern complex geopolitics, that having randomly selected people, you know, who don't necessarily, you know, haven't actually followed like the complexities of what's going on, it would mean a very steep learning curve for the randomly selected person. They'll probably do it. They'll probably, you know, people tend to live up to these expectations if you put them in that situation. But maybe you need a longer lead time on, you know, from election or selection to taking office or something, so that they can read up and get on top of things. I don't know. But yeah, random is good, I think. But at the same time, we need to pre-choose a seed somehow and stick to it and believe that it's a good seed, you know, or...
Get rid of the seeds.
What?
Get rid of the seeds.
No, 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 no. Seeds are good. Alright, is that it? Oh, yeah, okay.
I have a question.
Oh, right, okay.
Now we have been talking about electronic voting systems.
Well, I kind of lied a little bit. This wasn't really about electronic voting at all.
No, because I realized that it was also about manual voting.
Yeah.
And as we know, it's probably something like 2 to 3 billion people in the world who can't access electronic voting systems.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have any thoughts around that?
Well, this basically becomes the same answer as the illiteracy issue. So yes, there are lots of people who can't vote electronically because they have no means to do so. That is a problem. Maybe it's not a problem, you know, to begin with, but if this method works and it turns out to be a good idea, then we prefer to use it. So, in short term, you solve that by making providing voting computers, you know, nationwide. That's actually been working fairly well in India, although the voting machines they use in India are pretty easy to trick, turns out. A couple of people, including Rokongrai, have shown at least 3 different methods of falsifying a vote in the Indian voting computers. But you know, long term, people are going to have devices. There's 2.5 billion people who use internet right now, give or take, probably about 3 actually. And there's going to be another 2 billion coming online in the next, you know, 5 to 10 years. So I don't worry about this long term. And frankly, it'll probably take at least 5 to 10 years to make this a solid, workable thing and make sure, you know, and get somebody to actually adopt it.
If I get just one comment, you probably don't know that we actually have a project in Europe which started in Brussels when we founded PPEU.
Right.
And you said it was going to be expensive to build systems like that, and that was something we agreed upon there as well. So, and you asked for, probably some billionaires there who want to pay.
Mm-hmm.
What was suggested during these sessions in Brussels was to make states, countries, pay for developing systems like this.
Yeah.
Would that be more likely to to reach the goal within like a decade or two then?
Yeah. I mean, it's an imminently solvable problem. Partially, I just suck at organizing things. And so it would need somebody who is good at that to come and hold my hand a little bit. Or just run off and do it. I mean, I just gave you all the ingredients, so I'm not really needed in this process anymore.
Actually, Amsterdam is going to implement probably a democracy system. District of Amsterdam, one of the districts, we got a pirate elected, and it's in the agreement that they will develop this.
Okay. Cool. Well,
yes.
Yes, I have a question. What do you think is the bigger challenge? Writing the software? Is it more a technological challenge for making up the concept of that verifiable blockchain encryption thing? Or is it more the challenge to convince the traditional political system to adopt these technologies? I mean, like in Germany, we have very, very high requirements.
Yeah.
So this means that it doesn't only need to be verifiable,
mm-hmm.
but it needs to be verifiable by every voter. So
yeah.
that means that if you've got a piece of paper, then everybody can, of course, verify this if he goes to the location,
yeah.
and he can see how it is counted and stuff. But if you want to verify it on an e-voting level, then all people need to be crypto hackers or something
right.
like this. So this, on the one hand, there's a constitutional rule that says it must be verifiable. This is, of course, a problem because then it's always like, this is impossible.
Mm-hmm.
And because they're saying it is impossible, then people don't even start to go into that direction. So
yeah.
maybe we need more need to convince people to go in that direction. How can it be
yeah.
done?
Well, so I think having a constitutional rule of verifiability is really a good idea. It would be an even better idea if the voting system was being used to just actually verifiable. And the problem is that it isn't. You know, and it's pretty easy to show that it's not verifiable. You know, it might be have kind of Byzantine verifiability, but in reality, voter fraud is possible in every pencil paper voting system and every voting system that's being used. And that's just, it only takes, somebody with a spare piece of paper 2 minutes or, 20 seconds to cause voter fraud. And it happens all the time. It happens all around the world. So, I like the idea that, and probably Germany wouldn't adopt this kind of mechanism. But, compared to, I'd say the political problem of getting people to adopt this will be big, because people don't really like to change things like this, and there's good reasons why people don't change voting systems, very, very swiftly. You want to have lots of experience with the voting system. And also because changing the voting system tends to, it changes voter behavior quite a lot. And often unsettles things for a while people are getting used to the new system. So, that's a bigger problem. Writing the code, that's probably relatively easy, if it can be done at all, which is, there's a couple of unproven statements.
Yeah, okay. Now you just said in, before and also now that people can make a fraud, so they maybe betray.
Yeah,
but if you are voting with a pencil and with a paper, this doesn't really have a big effect because you cannot systematically push the voting results in a certain direction. Or how how would you achieve that?
So if you look at any of the cases of voter fraud, such as most recent elections in, I think it was Kazakhstan, or heck, if you go back to the Florida in the 2000 elections when Bush won, there's basically, there are websites where they just kind of list voting anomalies. So, and they call it anomalies just to not say that it's fraud, because sometimes it isn't, but voting anomalies are very, very common. The last Pakistani election, there was a large set of anomalies all over, It was better than it had been in previous years, and you know, election monitors were actually kind of like, "Hey, good job," you know. But there were problems, and so.
Yeah, but those problems were being reported, so they are sometimes visible to the people that have a look at it, and that is a sign that shows me that the
yeah.
control mechanisms work, because
well,
people come up with those.
Okay, so first off, you can't prove that all of the anomalies are detected. You can't prove that. Secondly, almost never, it is incredibly rare that any amount of detected voter fraud or anomalies or whatever trigger a re-election. It does happen, but it's really, really rare. And to the point where even announcing or talking about voting anomalies kind of doesn't really do anything. And very frequently the anomalies are so small, but yet could be abused so massively. So just as an example, in the last parliamentary election in Iceland, there were anomalies where the ballot boxes were supposed to be sealed. But there was no seal, meaning that anybody at any time could have opened the box and either removed things or put things in. And another kind of weird thing, there was a kind of counting station where the counters were supposed to be sealed inside of the room and nobody was supposed to be able to go in or out. And the there was a great video that somebody caught. Some news channel when they were going into the room where they took the seal. The decision making process is really important, and that's why that's why putting it into the hands of like half a dozen or a couple of hundred parliamentarians. As much as I like certain parliamentarians, frankly there's nothing that they're doing that can't be done better by the public. Yes, okay, the public isn't going to read as many reports or sit around thinking about it as heavily, but in the same way as the randomness seems to work fine, it probably works sufficiently in liquid democracy style situations, and that's a belief I'm willing to bet. And I think it's Winston Churchill's comment that democracy is the worst system of governance except all of the others. It's what we've got. Invent something better, please.
I agree with you and I disagree with you.
Okay.
I think, and I've been inside the system
yeah.
for 5 years and I've seen how it works. And I have been following the internal work of parliaments all over the world as a consequence of my interest in the system, and the system is broken.
Yeah.
And it's broken in such a way that now people have lost faith in the system. They don't believe in it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And that caves the path of the populists,
yeah.
hence the government in Iceland now.
Yeah.
Hence the situation where we can't change anything for 4 years,
mm-hmm.
again.
Yeah.
And this is the same thing all over the world. And if we don't do something about it very, very quickly, yeah, the gods agree with me. If you don't do the electronic...
That was me fiddling with something,
yeah.
but
no,
I,
don't,
I'm not
don't
involved.
Destroy this. It was
yeah.
Anyway. So I think we have to come up with solutions really fast.
Yeah.
And even if even if the original meaning of the rule of the people, or the power to the people, was to get power from the gods, maybe it is today to get power from the
oligarchs.
Yeah, the 1% or whatever,
yeah.
Who behave like gods or pretend they're gods. So, how can we? I don't really like another thing. I've created two political parties, and I'm confident that I don't believe in parties are the solution.
Right.
It's just a temporary vehicle
yeah.
to change things. And so my question is, since we started to talk about democracy, voting is just one thing. I don't really think voting is a solution to our problems either. The main thing is to involve the general public, and inspire them to be a part of the decision making process instead of handing over their power to the 1% and to the representatives, because they are handing off the responsibility.
No, I fully agree with all of that, and you know, the fact that we can't get rid of evil people from government until 4 years down the line is a stupid, stupid idea. We need to fix all of the system. What I was talking about today is a small, small part of that. We need to redo the entire thing, because parliamentary democracy as it is currently constructed was designed to meet the needs of relatively rich landowners several hundred years ago, who went on horses to make decisions with each other, and the conditions of participation back then were that you were rich enough to not have to work every day, and you had a horse, and really you had to be a man as well, and basically the entire thing is designed around those conditions. And they don't apply anymore. They just are not correct. Nobody has horses now, but still people are in parliament. So, we can redesign this shit, and we should, and the faster we do it, the better. Voting is going to be part of the solution, one way or another. It would be great if we could go all IATF on it and say, it doesn't matter what the choices are. The choices can be people. The choices can also be yes and no. Or
technically.
Technically,
the system can handle any choice.
Yeah. The only requirements, if I go back to it, is so the entire system is. A balloting method, which is just a way of registering your choice. And that can be a choice in people, it can be a choice in valid options, and so on. And you need a set of choices, and you need a social welfare function. That's all you need.
Yes, but the question is, what was your proposal? Electing people into a parliament with the software or with the system? Or exchanging the parliament by not having a parliament and letting the general public vote on any issue.
Yeah. So my point with this is, it could be used for either case. It can be used to vote people into parliament. If we're going to have parliaments at all, we should definitely use something that's both verifiable and unlinkable, if we can. But I would prefer not to have parliaments and to have better structures, And there would probably always be some kind of executive, people would always come together and make decisions in some way. The smaller the units, the better. The more fluid it is, the better. But, there's no reason why we need to have parliaments, I don't think. So that's not an assumption I'm making.
Okay, maybe not for decision making. But in a political system, we also need to have discussions and people that are raising issues and coming up and saying, look at this, this does not work, or this is a better solution. We need people that are maybe working into these things and advocating them. So the parliament has many functions, not only decision making. Another one is it's a kind of a communication platform for political issues.
Yes.
So then we also need to have a new, we not only substitute the decision making,
mm-hmm.
but also the other functions.
Yeah, and this is only a partial solution, I absolutely recognize that.
And in the German Pirate Party, when we introduced liquid feedback, then after a couple of months we found out it's not only, we have a tool for maybe making decisions, which are only recommendations in our case, but what we are missing is an e-portal for discussions. So this is, we can make decisions, but what we don't have is a kind of a structured discussion process.
Yeah, and that's needed too, and you need processes for proposing and amending documents and so on and so forth. There's millions of components, well, at least tens of components. But it is pretty simple, and actually, if you haven't read it, a good thing to read, you can get it on Project Gutenberg, is a book called Robert's Rules of Order. It is basically, it's a template, well, it's a way of conducting meetings and so on, and it has in it all of the things that you need, you know, deliberation processes, rules of procedure, decision-making processes, all of that stuff. And if you think of it as an abstract thing, it is exactly the same as the rules of procedure of every parliament, the bylaws of every organization. You know, everything is modelled more or less after the same principles as that. So it's a good thing to read. It gives you a good abstract thinking, a way of thinking about these problems.
Back on the discussion on democracy, we can also do it later on another coffee table.
I'm okay, I just thought there was another speaker.
I would say
I was told 15 minutes of questions. Okay.
I would say democracy always fails because democracy is always the people that rule other people. But whereas there's no option to opt out or decide, I don't want to be ruled in this way, which is always for the individual. It will always fail at a certain point.
Yeah, I agree. This is so another concept that I developed with a friend of mine is called supersidiarity, and it's this observation that you know. The traditional understanding of a state is it is an entity that that claims a monopoly or a legitimate monopoly over the claims a monopoly over the legitimate use of violence in a particular area, and through that monopoly they tend to be in control of everything. And a kind of hip and cool thing that everybody does nowadays is practices subsidiarity. You've probably heard this in European Union kind of things. And subsidiarity is basically the people at the top deciding that the people slightly lower down or even further down can participate in making this decision. And according to the principle, it's supposed to always happen. You're always supposed to have the smallest unit that can make the decision to make the decision, which in theory is supposed to activate the people. In practice, subsidiarity is done when you want to when you want to hide an issue. So, hey, we do subsidiarity on this thing, so that while you're doing that, we can get this other thing through. Or if we want to make sure that no decision gets made on a particular subject, and you know, just haha, subsidiarity, woohoo, no decision. And the other case where we really don't want to be responsible for the decision that gets made, let's do some subsidiarity thing and then people can blame themselves. And you know, those are really the only cases. It's just a community. The fourth one would be where actually the decision doesn't actually matter. Where you know it's just doing subsidiarity to make it kind of, ha, look, we're really good and democratic, we're practicing subsidiarity. And it's just not good enough. So the idea is, if we flip the entire system around, eliminate the top-down power structure and say, at the beginning, each person has the power to make decisions about anything that affects them. If other people are affected, then those people should have the ability to find out or know and be included on decisions. And that way you grow, as the decisions become more all-encompassing, so does the group that makes a decision on it. And
ability for an individual to feel like, hey, I don't want police to be able to run with guns and shoot people. They don't have the option to opt out of this system. They cannot veto or anything, which makes sense for an individual in a society of 60 million, but still sucks.
No, I don't think an individual in a society of 60 million or 600 million or 60 should be living in the threat that some guy comes and kills them legitimately because he happens to be wearing the right kind of uniform. That's just not acceptable. No society should accept that. And while we have Weimarian-style nation states, that's always going to happen every now and then. So elimination of the nation state or states in general is going to have to happen. How we make it happen and how we have stability as a society after it's happened, that is a complicated, complicated question, and I think we should have many long conversations about it. So. Okay. So, are we done? Should we just talk more over dinner, lunch, beer?
Let's take a 10-minute break.
Okay.
Yes. For the last speaker.
Thank you very much.